country that I was born in, Zambia, would not accept me, right? They because there was a point in which I would have had to claim citizenship, which I didn't know about, so I wasn't a citizen of Zambia. DR Congo did not acknowledge me as a citizen, even though my mother and my biological father were from DR Congo, partially because DR Congo used to be Zaire, it changed its government, you know, and also because I didn't adjust or claim status at a certain age. So I didn't qualify for being a, you know, citizen of either of those countries. The United States didn't want me. So what happens to individuals like myself who end up in deportation proceedings? Well, you can end up in a detention facility indefinitely, which was my greatest fear, because I didn't know what happened after that, right? What happens to people who are just in detention indefinitely? The other option that I thought was somewhat ironic at the time was they were looking for a third country to send me to. So a country that will just take me, right? That's what they do sometimes to individuals who have no country, who might be stateless, and they just want to get rid of them. Where can we send them? The irony was they were considering sending me to Mexico at the time, so I just find that to be a little bit ironic. But you know, I want to just kind of walk you through the psyche of someone who's going through something like this. It was utter fear and terror, right? Because you're being told that you don't exist. All the things that define a person, I didn't have. I didn't have a country, I didn't have a family, nor did I have a status, right? So in truth, I felt like I was a nobody, I didn't exist. And then I was walking into a courtroom, probably every 2 months, hearing someone tell me, a judge, right, and ICE telling me that I was a nobody, that I deserved to be deported, I deserved to be sent off somewhere. And then the reality was, well, what happens to me? Am I gonna die in a detention facility? And this was my life for 7 years, and having to balance that along with just trying to survive every day. Like, how am I gonna feed myself? How am I gonna clothe myself, right? So these were the realities that we all face every day, but you couple that with you're fighting for your life, and you're also fighting for your sanity, right? Because when you're being told you don't exist every day and you have to go on, well, what do? You have to be composed. You have to keep going. Well, how do you do that? And luckily for me, and this is something that I really you know, stress, and this is the kind of work I'm trying to do with others, is provide mental health support. So at the time, I was able to get mental health counseling, which is what allowed me to sustain myself throughout that journey. It was having my forensic psychologist who actually you know, diagnosed me with post-traumatic stress disorder, right? And I emphasize that as well, because when we think about all of these children that are walking into these courtrooms by themselves, they have no one, and they're minors. I mean, I was 18, I was 19, and I was diagnosed with PTSD. I would shiver, I would get sick before every court hearing. I cannot imagine a child, a minor, having to do that on their own. Statistically speaking, 85%